as we ready ourselves for the next part of the program, a few words about National Herald. Devi aur Sajan, National Herald Akhbar ka janm Swatantra Sangram ke jwalant dinon ke madhye mein Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru ji ke netritv mein 1938 ko hua. Aaj bhi Pandit ji ki kalam se ankit wo anmol vakya jo National Herald ke mukhprasht ke shikhar pe likha hai, wo utna hi prasangit hai shayad jitna tab tha. Freedom is in peril. Defend it with all your might. Swatantra khatre mein hai. इसकी रक्षा करने के लिए पूरी ताकत लगाएं। इस अखबार ने नेहरू जी के नए भारत के निर्माण के सपने को सदा अपना आदर्श माना. नया भारत एक आधुनिक, एक लोकतांत्रिक, न्याय संगत, उदारवादी समाज, सामाजिक समरसता और सामाजिक सद्भाव की परंपराओं से परिपूर्ण भारत. नेहरू जी के ये आदर्श और मूल्य आज भी नेशनल हेरल्ड की आत्मा है. अपने 8 दशक के इतिहास में नेशनल हेरल्ड ने जब इन मूल्यों का पहरा दिया तो हिंदी में उसका प्रारूप नवजीवन के रूप से और उर्दू में कौमी आवाज़ के नाम से जाना गया. युग बदलने के साथ नेशनल हेरल्ड ने डिजिटल मीडिया के महत्व को समझते हुए पिछले वर्ष नेहरू जयंती के उपलक्ष्य पर 14 नवंबर 2016 में अपनी वेबसाइट का बीटा वर्जन nationalheraldindia.com को लॉन्च किया. हमारा विश्वास आने वाले समय में नेशनल हेरल्ड भविष्य में एक प्रबल मीडिया संगठन के रूप में आगे आएगा. एज द स्टेज इज नाउ सेट, लेट मी इनवाइट ऑन स्टेज आवर चीफ गेस्ट ऑनरेबल प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया श्री प्रणब मुखर्जी जी, आवर गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर ऑनरेबल कांग्रेस प्रेसिडेंट श्रीमती सोनिया गांधी जी, our chairman, chairman of Associated Journals Limited, Honorable Motiwar Bora ji, and editor-in-chief, Nilab Mishra ji, to kindly come upon the stage. It is time to hear from the dignitaries present on the dais now. We all know of great contributions Shri Motilal Bora ji has made through his illustrious career, serving the nation in various capacities as a chief minister of Madhya Pradesh and as governor of Uttar Pradesh during the president's rule. But what makes us truly proud to have him as our chairperson is a not so well known fact. The fact that he indeed started his journey as a journalist himself and remains a journalist by heart. It is my great pleasure to invite our chairman, Shri Motilal Bora ji, to come upon the stage and say a few words.
माननीय राष्ट्रपति जी, आदरणीय कांग्रेस अध्यक्ष श्रीमती सोनिया गांधी जी, पूर्व प्रधानमंत्री डॉक्टर मनमोहन सिंह जी, नेशनल हेराल्ड के संपादक नीलम मिश्रा जी और माननीय अतिथिगण, यह अत्यंत सुखद संयोग है कि इस वर्ष हमारी स्वाधीनता के 70 वर्ष पूरे हो रहे हैं. इसी के साथ यह वर्ष श्रीमती इंदिरा गांधी का जन्म शताब्दी वर्ष भी है. इससे अधिक सफलता की बात क्या हो सकती है कि ऐसे शुभ वर्ष में बीच के कुछ व्यवधान के बाद नेशनल हेराल्ड का एक नए रूप में पुनः प्रकाशन आरंभ हो रहा है. मुझे यह बताने की जरूरत नहीं है कि नेशनल हेराल्ड का प्रकाशन देश की स्वाधीनता की चेतना को एक नया और ओजस्वी स्वर देने के लिए हुआ था. यह भी कितने ऐतिहासिक महत्व की बात है कि इसकी स्थापना और किसी ने नहीं, स्वयं महान स्वाधीनता सेनानी और आधुनिक भारत के निर्माता पंडित जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने की थी। हम इस अवसर पर उनके साथ सभी स्वतंत्रता संग्राम सेनानियों को नमन करते हैं। माननीय राष्ट्रपति जी, आपने इस अवसर पर उपस्थित होकर नेशनल हेराल्ड के इस अंक को मुख्यतिथि के रूप में ग्रहण करने की अनुमति दी और यहाँ हम सबके बीच में उपस्थित हुए। इसके लिए हम एसोसिएटेड जर्नल लिमिटेड की ओर से आपका स्वागत करते हैं और हृदय से आभार व्यक्त करते हैं। डॉक्टर मनमोहन सिंह जी का सहयोग और सद्भावना सदा हमारे साथ रही है, मैं उनका भी हार्दिक स्वागत करता हूँ। कांग्रेस अध्यक्ष श्रीमती सोनिया गांधी जी का मार्गदर्शन हमें सदैव मिलता रहा है, इसके लिए धन्यवाद की औपचारिकता न निभाकर मैं उनका आदर पूर्वक स्वागत करता हूँ। नेशनल हेराल्ड की यात्रा सदैव संघर्षों एवं कष्ट के रास्ते से गुजरी है। आप यह भी जानते हैं कि यह संघर्ष किसी न किसी रूप में आज भी चल रहा है, लेकिन मुझे विश्वास है कि आप सब के सहयोग से हम इसमें सफल होंगे। मुझे विश्वास है कि नेशनल हेराल्ड अपने संस्थापक और इससे जुड़े उन महापुरुषों के कल्पना और सपनों के मुताबिक भविष्य में भी चलता रहेगा। इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ मैं आपको एक बात अवश्य कहना चाहूँगा, पंडित जवाहरलाल जी नेहरू एक ऐसे आधुनिक भारत के निर्माता के साथ साथ उन्होंने इस बात की सोच और कल्पना की थी कि देश में जब तक हम विज्ञान के क्षेत्र में, तकनीकी ज्ञान के क्षेत्र में आगे नहीं आएंगे, तब तक हम देश में, हमारे देश को जो विकसित राष्ट्र हैं, वे केवल कहेंगे हिंदुस्तान तो सांप सपेरों का देश है, रस्सी पे चलने वालों का देश है। मुझे कहने में कोई संकोच नहीं कि पंडित जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने प्रतापगढ़ की एक आम सभा में किसानों और मजदूरों को संबोधित करते हुए इस बात को कहा था कि विज्ञान और तकनीकी ज्ञान का होना बहुत जरूरी है। पंडित जी के साथ में जो लोग बैठे थे उनमें से एक आदमी उठा, उन्होंने कहा कि पंडित जी, ये किसान और मजदूर विज्ञान और तकनीकी की बात को क्या समझेंगे? तो उन्होंने कहा, नहीं, इनकी संतानें, इनके लड़के और लड़कियां हिंदुस्तान की वे विज्ञान और तरक्की को आगे बढ़ाएंगे। आज हम कह सकते हैं दुनिया के सभी मुल्कों की तुलना में दुनिया के लोग जो कहते थे कि हिंदुस्तान आगे नहीं बढ़ सकता, उसी हिंदुस्तान ने पंडित जी के मार्गदर्शन में उस मुकाम को हासिल किया। तकनीकी ज्ञान रखने वाले लोगों को आज भी देश के और विदेश के सभी लोग दांतों तले उंगली दबाकर सोचे कि आखिर ये कैसा हुआ। ये हुआ शिक्षा के तरफ पंडित जी का बहुत बड़ा रुझान था, उन्होंने देश में महाविद्यालय विश्वविद्यालय की स्थापना की। मेरा कहने का मतलब है कि आज अगर हम विज्ञान के क्षेत्र में और तकनीकी ज्ञान के क्षेत्र में तरक्की कर पाए हैं तो पंडित जवाहरलाल जी नेहरू की सबसे बड़ी देन है और आज हम उनका अखबार, हमारा अखबार और आप सबका अखबार नेशनल हेराल्ड। शायद आपको संभव तब पता नहीं होगा कि पंडित जी कई बार दौरे के समय रात को नेशनल हेराल्ड के ऑफिस में पहुंचकर दिन भर के दौरों का समाचार खुद ही बता दिया करते थे। गजब की बात थी, ऐसा इतने व्यस्त होते हुए भी उन्होंने अपनी कलम नहीं छोड़ी, कलम के धरी हुए थे। मैं अधिक समय न लेते हुए आप सबको धन्यवाद देता हूँ कि आप सब लोग यहाँ उपस्थित हुए। धन्यवाद। जय हिंद।
A former Prime Minister, Shrimati Indira Gandhi, once described her father, India's first Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, as, and I quote, "the humanity in a human being." This generation has been fortunate to have a person who represents the same values. Her humanity, humility, and concern for the well-being of every Indian has not only helped define the soul of Indian National Congress in our times, but also has left the most profound imprint on our national polity in 21st century. As the head of our family and lighthouse of our values, her leadership continues to inspire each one of us. It is indeed my pleasure to welcome Shrimati Sonia Gandhi, President of the Indian National Congress.
Lal Vora, Shri Nilab Misra, distinguished guests, friends, it gives me great pleasure to welcome the Honorable President Shri Pranab Mukherjee and all our distinguished guests on this very special occasion, the launch of the commemorative publication of the National Herald as India celebrates 70 years of independence. We have come a long way since 1947, and we rejoice together as Indians. But while we celebrate the achievements of our past, we must also look within so that we can shape a better future. The story of the National Herald is in many ways the story of modern India. The intellectual force behind its founding in September 1938 was, of course, Jawaharlal Nehru, who served as its founding editor and as the first architect of India as an independent nation. He was not alone, for his was an age of towering visionaries of rare dedication. He followed in the footsteps of Mahatma Gandhi and other great pioneers, and in turn was accompanied by a host of luminaries, the like of which few countries or societies have witnessed. The newspaper Nehru founded reflect what that generation stood for, while today we find ourselves increasingly divided in the name of class or caste, religion and region. The National Herald is a testament to those great leaders who rose beyond individual ambition to project and protect the very soul of this land. Unity, peace and justice, not division and conflict, were the lights that guided them in thought as well as in action. These leaders, Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Patel, Maulana Azad, Dr. Ambedkar, and so many others, have left behind matchless legacies that have stood the test of time and the turbulence of history. It is one of the ironies of our present times that the soaring reach of their work is now thought to be either obliterated or in some cases appropriated by individuals and groups who are in direct opposition to their beliefs and principles. Those who stood aside when history was painfully made by sacrifice and struggle, those who indeed had little faith in the constitution adopted by our country, are now seeking to create an India completely at odds with the one that saw the light of independence on August 15, 1947. Let us not forget that they made no sacrifices to shape India's destiny. Though their language is modern, they seek to take India backward to further their narrow sectarian vision. Their modern jargon conceals pre-modern beliefs, concepts that are at odds with the progressive and inclusive thought, with contemporary knowledge, and with a vision for the future. It is our duty to pull away the hypocrisy and reveal the reality lurking beneath. Today, that tried and tested idea of India has been thrown fundamentally into question by rising intolerance, by malevolent forces that tell Indians what they cannot eat, who they cannot love, what they cannot say, indeed, what thoughts they cannot hold. And all this is being encouraged by a culture of vigilante violence, actively supported by those who are supposed to enforce the law. Such examples assault our consciousness almost daily. India has reached a crossroads marked by increasing threats of authoritarianism and bigotry. Where we choose to stand today is where our country will head tomorrow. As Nehru wrote, idealism is tomorrow's realism. Even in the darkest of hours, we must preserve the flame of our national ideals. If we accept without scrutiny, without question, without a challenge, the fallacies and follies we are witness to today, we will leave for our children, for our future generation, a land of injustice, a legacy of trauma, and a country divided and broken. We are in a war of ideas. We wage this war to preserve our ideals, which have built India up as a model of democracy, diversity, and coexistence. When these ideals are threatened, India itself is in danger. And if we do not raise our voices, if we do not speak up, our silence will be taken as consent. We have daunting enough battles to fight against injustice, against poverty, against prejudice, against patriarchy, against malnutrition, against illiteracy, against communalism, but we must also prevail in this greater war for the soul of our nation. Ours is a mission to preserve the credibility and sanctity of our institutions in their democratic design. Mahatma Gandhi's ideas of truth, Jawaharlal Nehru's celebration of pluralism, Sardar Patel's vision of unity, Dr. Ambedkar's legacy of social justice, these are what we must fight for. The National Herald evokes a time when nationalism fought for a rule. But domestic misrule is as great a challenge for our country. At a time when inclusive conception of our nation is under attack, and the press is pressured to obey and applaud rather than to question, speaking truth to power is the imperative of our age. The National Herald is a reminder of what is precious about the India its founders fought to free. So let us work together for its success, for the ideals it embodies. Let us work together to safeguard an India in which each person's voice can be raised and heard. Most of all, the voices of those who question and disagree. We recognize today that it is only through such an ongoing conversation, always lively, often even heated and noisy, that our future as a united and peaceful India can be affirmed and ensured. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Now for the release of the commemorative publication, may I request the Congress President to please present the first copy to Honorable President of India, Shri Pranab Mukherjee. Encouraged by the response that beta version of nationalheraldindia.com received after its launch on Pandit Nehru's birth anniversary in 2016. Today on this special occasion, National Herald is also coming out with its full service version 2 website and digital presence. As the commemorative publication was released, a full service website has also gone live. As you can see, you can get a glimpse of the website. आज हमारे मुख्य अतिथि भारत के प्रथम नागरिक हैं। उनका जीवन हम सभी के लिए प्रेरणा का स्रोत है। स्वतंत्रता संग्राम से जुड़े परिवार में जन्मे, वो एक ऐसे नेता हैं जिन्होंने भारत को गुलामी की जंजीरें तोड़ एक महान राष्ट्र के रूप में उभरते करीब से देखा है। ज्ञान के सागर के रूप में प्रसिद्ध हमारे राष्ट्रपति महोदय ने लगभग 6 दशकों में सामाजिक राजनीतिक जीवन में योजना आयोग के उपाध्यक्ष से लेकर भारत राष्ट्र के रक्षा और वित्त मंत्री जैसे महत्वपूर्ण पदों पर रहकर देश की सेवा की। भारतीय संविधान के संरक्षक के रूप में आपने देश की लोकतांत्रिक मूल्यों को संजोए रखा। मैं भारत के राष्ट्रपति श्री प्रणब मुखर्जी जी से विनम्र अनुरोध करूंगा कि अपने विचारों और विवेक को साझा कर हम सभी को अनुग्रहित करें।
Mr. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's indeed a privilege for me to be present amidst you on this happy occasion and receiving the first copy of the relaunched National Herald. Today, a soldier and a witness of the Indian freedom struggle has risen again. National Herald began its journey during the dark days of colonial years. That was an era where subjects of the crown refused to accept subjugation as their fate. They aspired to be free citizens of a free land, to be masters of their own fate. National Herald gave voice to the freedom movement, but more than that, it gave a voice to the hopes and aspirations of every Indian. It represented a cause, the cause of freedom. Commercial considerations were always secondary and almost non-existent. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, for every Indian from that era, aspirations for freedom were not just about a change in the political stewardship, but were aimed at creating a new India for every Indian. Mahatma Gandhi, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, and many others, the paper gave a voice to the freedom struggle. The British shut the paper down for 3 years on 15th August 1942 in the context of the Quit India movement already launched by International Congress on 8th August 1942. The immediate cause and so-called provocation for the rulers of that time to come heavily on National Herald because of the editorial appeared in the paper titled Bande Mataram. Its editor, Damarao, was imprisoned for writing against the inhuman living conditions of the freedom fighters in prison. It resumed its publication on November 11, 1955. The paper marked its return with an editorial titled Jai Hind, written by Panditji himself. The editorial represented the yearning of every Indian to break free from the chain of slavery. Below, the masterhead of the National Herald, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, had inscribed the words, "Freedom is in peril, defend it with all your might." These words may have been written in 1939, but has its application and relevance for all time whenever freedom is in danger and truly in peril. Eternal vigilance is the price of liberty and freedom, and that vigilance can never be passive. It must be active, and active vigilance is the need of the hour. Our struggle for freedom was driven by Mahatma's commitment to truth and non-violence. In a world where might was considered right, Mahatma Gandhi told the world that means were as important as the end. Our struggle then was for freedom against oppression from foreign rule. Our struggle today is to defeat the demons of poverty, hunger, disease, in line with the transformational characteristics of our constitution, which was just not an instrument for administering the country, but which was the most significant Magna Carta of socio-economic transformation. you are aware of the fact that Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, even as Prime Minister, was in the habit of writing to his friends very frequently. And in that course of correspondence, immediately after the completion of the Constitution, drafting of the Constitution, where adult suffrage was granted to the people of India, his friend of Cambridge University, earlier British Foreign Secretary, later became British Prime Minister, commented to him that you are always visionary. You always dream and we are afraid. Your dream will come to your frustration. Even in February of 1952, Times in London headline was, when the general election was being held, that India took a giant leap and with a question whether it was in darkness. But same Sir Anthony Eden, who wrote to Nehru in 1950 that you were a dreamer, later on described the Indian Constitution, which we have just narrated, that it is not a document for transacting administrative business, but it is a Magna Carta of a socio-economic transformation of a huge population that is called India. What we have achieved in the last 70 years surely is not merely some steel plants or dams or some powerhouses. It is much more than that. When you adopted the Constitution, please shut your eyes and keep in your memory when you are old enough. When you are young, please turn the pages of the history. Bloodbath was taking place. Communal frenzy was in an unprecedented scale. Lord Mountbatten, the last Governor General and Viceroy, then of course he ceased to be Viceroy, but just Governor General, observed that I have deployed 50,000 armed forces in western border of India, partitioned India, but we could not prevent tremendous and fierce communal riots. But on the eastern sector, I have peace because there is one man boundary force, Mahatma Gandhi, who is traveling in the villages of then East Bengal, now Bangladesh. In that context, to have a secular democratic constitution was not easy. It is not merely a theoretical proposition. And Panditji himself confirmed, when he was asked by Andre Muda, it was after the general election of 1957, that Mr. Nehru, you have surpassed the average tenure of any British Prime Minister except Sir Robert Walpole. What do you feel has been the most challenging job to you in more than 10 years? His reply was, to convert a highly religious country into modern secular belief and doctrine. Therefore, in these 70 years, as I was telling, is not merely the question of this economic development or that regional prosperity or some statistical satisfactions from where we have traveled to where, but it is much more. To my mind, as an ordinary man of this country, when I feel what a gigantic task has been achieved to have in a country of 1.3 billion people, when your daily life, 200 Indian languages and dialects are being used in some part of the country or other, all major seven religions of the world are being practiced in some part of this country, all three major ethnic groups in huge conglomeration, Dravidians, Caucasians, Mughalites, are living in an united country under one constitution, under one flag, in peace and harmony. Therefore, sure, we shall have to ponder upon, pause, and reflect when we read in the newspaper or see in the television screen that an individual is being lynched because of some alleged violation of law or not. When mob frenzy becomes so high and irrational, uncontrollable, we have to pause and reflect. Are you vigilant enough? I am not talking of vigilantism. I am talking of, are you vigilant enough proactively to say the basic tenets of our life? Because we cannot avoid it. Posterity will demand an explanation from us that what have you done? I raised this question in myself when I read in the pages of history as a young student that how in a battle which was sure to win in Bengal, Battle of Plassey in 1757, was lost by traitors, and as a result 190 years colonial rule was established on this country. It's a fact that after winning the battle of 1757 and a few battles in south, Battle of Arcot 1, 2 and 3, within 17 years of Battle of Plassey, British power became truly the paramount power in India, and they ruled for 190 years. Therefore, I am not going to suggest that there is any apprehension of the old type of colonialism to come back. But colonialism has always taken its different phase with the change of history. Exploitation, dominance, by one power to another power. Why in these 70 years, India persistently, I'm sorry, this is a forgotten word today, but during our days, and I had the privilege of presiding that ministry twice, why Panditji spoke of non-alignment on C, developmental cooperation between South and South, because in one of the recent publications of the United Nations Development Index, it is found that despite 22 years of signing the WTO agreement, solemn commitment of the world leaders to bring trade equalization and abolish the non-tariff barrier, 80 least developed countries of the world, their indebtedness have increased. That was the rationality for which you talked of South-South cooperation, for which you talked of India must be on the right side of the people, of the awakening of new countries deserving freedom from the colonial roots and exploitation. How many years it took Namibia to be independent? How many years it took for South Africa to be free from apartheid? Because I had the privilege of signing the agreement with South Africa after Mandela came back to power and apartheid was abolished in the early 90s as Commerce Minister of India, because the government of India under Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was the first country to stop trade, international trade with South Africa at the cost of having a serious damage on our international freedom. Therefore, these 70 years were eventful years for Indians. And as I believe, and I am particularly glad to have the opportunity to receive the relaunching of National Award, National Herald, because papers like these, and almost every paper, when I see around, I find many distinguished editors and media persons. I will appeal to them that your duty, your job has never come to an end, and it will never come to an end. Because of you, democracy survives. People's rights are preserved. Human dignity is maintained. Slavery is kept away. You will have to keep your vigilance. I'm sorry I'm using the word repeatedly, but I don't find any alternative appropriate word, because I do believe that citizens' vigilance, intellectuals' vigilance, newspapers and media's vigilance can act as the biggest deterrent to the forces of darkness and backwardness. Ladies and gentlemen, I would not like to take more of your time. I will conclude by just repeating the history, because very recently I had the opportunity of speaking in a function organized by a press club that is in Calcutta for 200 years of India's newspaper. First newspaper publication took place. Newspaper published in Indian language in Calcutta on 15th June 1817. Long before that, first newspaper in India, all over India, was published in 1780 from Calcutta.
And in these 200 years of Indian journalism, I found how, with tremendous efforts during those days, whether Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Kesari, whether Lala Lajpat Rai's Tribune, whether Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru's National Herald, earlier Surendranath Banerjee's Nation, every newspaper, editor, journalist, they boldly faced the oppression, and whenever there was any attempt to carve the freedom, they were the first to fight. Therefore, always we shall have to keep in mind what was said by one eminent journalist, that my motto is nothing but freedom first, freedom now, freedom forever. Thank you.